The words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please take a seat. Sometimes the Bible can be a difficult thing for us to manage. Sometimes. Days that end in Y, I think. And we have quite often I find that we have a number of approaches to it. One of them is to just ignore the bits we don't like. Have you ever found yourself doing, we do that sometimes in our liturgies. Like we'll stop a story just before it gets really bloodthirsty. We'll stop a psalm just before we talk about something really confronting. Or when you're the preacher and you come across something and you just go, whoop, let's just skip that. I'll focus on the epistle today. And we do that ourselves. The other way we do it is we hyper-focus on them. And we try and explain them away, perhaps, or we want to say that this reveals something. Much of the Old Testament, not all, but much of the Old Testament is actually quite confronting if you read it. These days it would never get sort of a PG rating. If you wanted to show it as a movie to kids, the Old Testament, there's blood, there's people being decapitated and cut into bits, and it's quite confronting. Now, what do you do with that? One approach, which I think is actually quite helpful, is to recognize that perhaps the most powerful thing Scripture can do is show us our own tendencies to be violent, so that being confronted with them, we have the choice to change. Not to reinforce them, not to go, oh look, they were really brutal back then, you go out and do the same thing. But rather to go, this is what brutality looks like. Do you want that? And we say no. And we're given the opportunity to change by the grace of God. That's the first thing. The second thing is we like to think we have a lot of significance and power in the world. You can see it most when things go wrong. When things go wrong. People go, what did I do? Now, I mean, sometimes what did you do? Is you were stupid. For example, let's say you were sort of 40-ish or so, and you were trying to show off to the other people in, say, your Taekwondo class, and you tried to do something and you ended up with a sprained ankle. What did I do? I was stupid. Sometimes it's that simple. Sometimes it's not what did I do, but something someone else did, you know. You're at home and someone breaks into your house. It's not you, it's them. Or perhaps a more pertinent example, you're a subsistence farmer on a small Pacific Island nation, and people around the world have done so much damage to the environment that sea levels are rising and your farm is no longer sustainable. Well, what did you do? You scraped out a living. What did other people do? Which is fine. But sometimes there's things happen that aren't because of someone else. Not because you were foolish, not because somebody else was greedy, but because sometimes things happen. And still we want to imbue ourselves with such a significance that we have the capacity to affect the world at a distance. But technically, that's called magic. You know? The whole idea behind magic is you can say some words over here and it'll have effect over there that's not connected. You can cause it. That's magic. And we think we're magical. We think we're like the pixies and the fairies and unicorns. You know? What did I do wrong that there was a volcano? Nothing. Volcanoes happen. And we think the mechanism for this is God, quite often. God is punishing us for something we've done wrong. And the reading from Numbers, People have sinned because they haven't sinned because they necessarily are upset, but they've sinned because they're turning their backs on God. And there are serpents that appear, and they blame God. I've got a problem with that. So that's the first place where I want this text to confront me and say, how often do I blame God for something that's not God's fault? How often am I committing the sin of those Israelites? God, why did you do that? No. Don't blame God. Sometimes things happen. And what the Israelites discover, though, is that in this experience, God is with them. So they go to Moses and they say, well, we've done the wrong thing. We turned our backs on God. Please pray to God and ask for help. And Moses prays, and the solution is more snakes. Doesn't seem like a sensible solution, does it? And it's not necessarily more snakes, it's just one more, and it's made of bronze, and it's on a pole. But it says something about healing. It says something about us being involved in the process of healing, which is sometimes the way to be healed is to confront the problem. A while ago, I had a pinched nerve somewhere back there from working on the computer too much. I went to the physio and said, look, it hurts, but it doesn't hurt if I do this. And the physio says, yes, if you repeat the problem, the pain will go away for a short while. Face the problem. So he had me doing these weird exercises where I stand up and do stretches and stuff, and it hurt. It hurt. But you know what? After a couple of weeks, I considered the computer and worked for a while, and it didn't hurt. So I went back to the physio, and goes, this is like amazing. He says, well, now I've got another round of exercises, so it doesn't hurt. But, you know, I'm okay. Sometimes if we repeat the problem, if we run away from the pain, we don't go to healing. And that's true in a lot of areas of life. It's true in physiotherapy, in my experience. But it's also true with our own sinful nature. The way we can turn away from that is by first seeing it. Having the courage to confront it. So that by the grace of God, we might change. In the gospel passage, Jesus is referencing that Old Testament story. John 3. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. There are many definitions of what it is to be sinful. You know, and there are lists. You can actually, you've got the fake free time, go for it. You can go online and you can Google different people's lists of sins. And some of them are like 200 or 300 lines long. This is a sin, that's a sin, this is a sin, that's a sin. You know? There's some fairly short lists. Jesus has a three list. Love God, love neighbor, as you love yourself. That's a pretty short list. I mean, it's not easy to do, but it's a short list. One of the definitions I've always found to be helpful is to treat God or God's creation as being less significant than yourself. We forget that we're part of God's creation. We think, that's not as important as me. God's not as important as me. We elevate ourselves above God and the rest of God's creation. And we are confronted by that because in the crucifixion, we see that people for political and personal and financial gain did that with Christ. They saw their own political or financial gain is being more important than God and God's most perfect creation in one, in Jesus Christ. And that was lifted up on the cross. And we're confronted by that. So we have a choice. We can face that. We can look to the cross and seek healing. Or we can run away from the problem and never change. I encourage you to look to the cross. In the name of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Amen.